Thank you for joining us today on this Veterans Day, on this very cold Veterans Day. You people in Wyoming are tough, tough people, and I admire you, but I enjoy being in Atlanta where it's a little bit warmer. We're pleased to have you joining us today for this very special webinar that is presented and sponsored in conjunction with the Manufacturing Works Group of Wyoming. And the topic today is when what's going around affects your bottom line. We'd like to invite you to become our friend at Facebook. That's, you're not going to show that one, Guy? Okay,
no,
we'll give you the disclaimer.
Okay.
The disclaimer today, the presentation that we're making today is not complete without the accompanying oral comments and discussion. And the work product provided must be read in conjunction with your organization's personal counsel. In addition, the information given and comments made should not be interpreted as legal advice or legal opinion. We're pleased to have our presenter today is Guy Higgins. Guy is the principal at Firestorm. He is a former U.S. Naval officer. Went to the Naval Academy and has a lot of experience working in the naval business and the aerospace business. He's worked with Boeing, etc. Also on the line today is Jennifer Friedman. She's also a principal of Firestorm, and Jennifer's background is marketing and communications and strategic development. We're so pleased to have Amanda Hansen of the Manufacturing Works with us. Amanda is there in Cheyenne, and she is trying to warm up, huddling herself around the screen, hoping that gives off a little bit of heat here. Amanda, would you have any comments or introductory things that you would like to tell us about Manufacturing Works?
Yes, well, first, thank you everyone for joining us today. Many of you are familiar with Manufacturing Works, but just to make sure we give you a quick recap, we are here in Wyoming. I'm the representative in Southeast Wyoming, and we have representatives across the state. We're here to help manufacturers, and we offer a number of services, everything from engineering solutions, from engineers like me who can help with technical problems and questions and analysis, to business growth solutions. We can help with innovating new ideas, sales, growing through exporting, and other tools. We have efficiency, energy, and environmental solutions to help make sure you've got a good plan for environmental impacts. We can do energy analysis to help minimize energy use and avoid sales tax for manufacturers who are exempt and don't need to be paying that tax. And we've got management solutions with, we've got marketing advice, and we have had graphic designers on the team to help out. And we're now pleased to be adding to our suite of services help from Firestorm with business resilience. These experts, Guy and Jennifer and their whole team, help businesses prepare for the unexpected.
Okay. This is Guy, and just a little bit about us. Firestorm is a company that helps other companies. We're business to business, and we help companies prepare for emergencies and crises. And we work across the entire spectrum from planning all the way through execution and recovery. And we like to say that we empower people to manage risk and crisis. So with that, what I would like to do is just take a quick look at what's going on in the world. So the doctor who was in West Africa treating Ebola patients back to the U.S. and was subsequently diagnosed with Ebola is now Ebola-free and will be released from the hospital in New York today. So that's a good thing. But at the same time, on the other coast, there are 18,000 California nurses who are striking because they feel that the preparedness, they're not being trained and they're not being provided with the resources to deal with Ebola should they experience it in California. So there's a two-day strike out there. And I know that the next bullet's going to come as an absolute shock to everybody out here in the Front Range and in Wyoming, is that the polar vortex has hit us. I just looked. It says my computer says it's 4 degrees in Cheyenne. So it is a bit brisk. In the other direction, recently, just yesterday, hackers compromised the U.S. Postal Service web's internet and may have compromised 500,000 personally identifiable information files on Postal Service employees. So that cyber area continues to be a concern. And then finally, a little bit down the way there's a new computer simulation out that has looked at how germs get distributed within commercial airliners. In terms of if you're sitting there someplace in the airplane and someone else sneezes, how much at risk are you? And that new computer simulation is out, and it indicates that the airflow is generally from the center of the airplane out to the periphery, out to the fuselage, and not longitudinally down the length of the airplane. But those are some things that are going on right now in the world. So with that, I want to go into some background. And since Ebola has been and remains in the news, worldwide have been reported over 13,000 cases and over 5,000 deaths. And the World Health Organization is still saying that the number of cases could peak at over 1 million before this particular outbreak of Ebola is ended sometime next year. Severe respiratory illness.
Sorry, this is Jennifer. Before you go on, but it is important to note that here in the United States, Ebola is not at any kind of a crisis level. It may be at some time, but right now there are not any clusters of Ebola. So that's good news. It's happening in the world right now. We're still on low alert for Ebola, but we still need to watch it.
That is absolutely true. The severe respiratory illness, enterovirus D68, there have been almost 300 cases, reported confirmed cases in the U.S., and of those 300 or so confirmed cases, there have been 4 deaths. That's mostly in younger children, but not exclusively. And it has been linked to paralysis, but there are no clear ties to that, and so there's a lot of concern, a lot of uncertainty about it. And uncertainty over communicable illnesses is one of the areas that is really something needs to be addressed in thinking about communicable illness. But as Jennifer said, Ebola, even with 13,000 cases globally and 5,000 deaths globally with the enterovirus, influenza season is upon us. And every year there are almost 50,000 deaths in the U.S. from flu. And that's something that really needs to be taken in consideration. Influenza is still a very dangerous disease, and we'll touch on that as well as some of the other ones. But beyond influenza and SRI and Ebola, there are 80 communicable illnesses that the Center for Disease Control and various state health agencies want to have reported to them. 30 of those can be transmitted from human to human. And so those are the ones that we're really going to be mostly concerned with from a business perspective, is the ones that have human-to-human transmission. Things like Rocky Mountain spotted fever and Lyme disease and those insect-borne diseases are not transmitted human-to-human. Doesn't mean they're not important, but we're going to focus on the human-to-human transmissions. I want to just touch a little bit in the background here on the immunization scare. When there has been a significant throughout the U.S. decline in childhood immunizations. Now, that is in terms of a few hundred in a state or thousands across the country, not in the millions, but it is still important. And because of that decrease, there have been a number of phenomena that we've seen, one of which is that there has been a decrease in what's called the herd immunity. Herd immunity is that phenomena that exists where if you are a person who has not been immunized against a specific disease, but everyone else in the community has been, you effectively have immunity because no one else can bring in the disease and you're not going to catch it from somebody else. But it only takes a few percentage, a small percentage of the population to not be immunized before herd immunity becomes significantly less effective. And it can become a major problem. There have been on the West Coast in Washington State and California, there have been significant outbreaks of diseases that were previously well controlled, like whooping cough, diphtheria, and those diseases are registering in the hundreds of cases. So what does it take for something to be a communicable illness? Number one, there needs to be a virulent organism. So influenza certainly qualifies for that. It needs to be easily transmitted from human to human, and we humans need to have a lack of immunity. That's why the vaccinations are so important, is to build up that immunity and break the chain. So those are the things that we need to have: virulent organism, easily transmitted from human to human, and a lack of immunity. So when I say easily transmitted from human to human, there's a number of different ways that you can do that. You can have a contact transmission where there's direct or indirect contact between someone who has the disease and someone who doesn't. Direct contact is you or me directly contacting someone who has the disease and getting it directly from them. Indirect contact means someone who has a head cold, which is communicable, certainly, wipes their nose and then opens a door with a doorknob, and then 5 minutes later I come along and I take the doorknob and then I wipe my eyes. There's a likelihood that I can get the cold directly from that indirect contact. So by touching the doorknob, transmitting the pathogen to myself, to the mucus or the mucous membranes around my eyes, I can get the disease that way.
Guy, yes. I'm going to stop for just a minute and just kind of break the code here. Just, it's probably pretty obvious, but the P1 is person one, the P2 is person two.
Okay, thanks, Jennifer. So droplet transmission means that rather than like a doorknob, that there's actually a fluid involved somewhere along the line and that the pathogen is transmitted in that fluid. So that's one of the areas where Ebola is an example, a gross example of one, but we've heard so much about it that I'm going to use that as the example here. Airborne transmission is that thing in the simulation in the airplane where there is someone sneezes and it is transferred through the air without any visible moisture or anything like that in very small particles or droplets. And it can be just someone exhaling and their breath contains the pathogen. So we can get those, the disease can be transmitted in any one of those ways. So when we talk about communicable illness, I mentioned that there are 30 of them that pass from human to human. This is just a range of what they are, but it's important to look at this because things like MSRA, Methicillin-Resistant Streptococcus, is a serious strep infection. And is becoming resistant to antibiotics. And so that's an important area for us to look at. Meningitis is transmittable human to human. Tuberculosis is transmittable human to human. And we need to be concerned about things like that. It's not just the various flus, influenza strains that are shown there, or the enterovirus D68, but it is things as that raise hackles on the back of our necks, like meningitis and tuberculosis, that we need to be careful of. And so we really need to focus on how we can watch that. But there's more to it than that. I mentioned before the decline in vaccinations, particularly among children. So there have been whooping cough, pertussis outbreaks in California, resulted in 10 infants dying in 2013, and then there was an outbreak this year in Maryland. Now, pertussis typically strikes children, but mumps, there's been several outbreaks of mumps this year, and mumps can strike children, can strike adults. And mumps in adults, while it's serious in children, is much more serious in adults. And you can see that there have been outbreaks in all these different universities where kids get together in dorms and it's a communicable situation. The same thing can happen in a business. So we need to be careful about these kinds of things and be alert for outbreaks of diseases, even though they may look as though to strike us as being childhood diseases. The same thing with measles. Now here's a case where it shows how the number of cases of measles have increased over the years, and you can see a big spike There are just recently a number of measles cases going out. Once again, that's reflective of the decline in childhood immunization. And if you don't get immunized when you're a child, then as an adult, you can be subject to it. And you can come down with the measles. And measles is a serious disease. It can, it, you can die from a case of the measles. An important thing to look, yes.
I'm sorry, I'm interrupting you, but it, you might want to mention too the background on the reason that people are not getting the reason people are not getting their children immunized, and the fact that it was all based on a bogus study.
Okay, so as Jennifer said, there was a study performed by a British physician years ago, and it was published in the British journal Lancet, the equivalent of the Journal of the American Medical Association in Britain. It was published, and the conclusion of that study was that the preservative used in vaccines, thimerosal, was causally related to autism. And of course, that raised a great deal of concern among parents. That study has been debunked, and in fact, the doctor who performed the study has had his license to practice medicine in the United Kingdom nullified and canceled. He can no longer practice medicine in the UK, and studies have been shown again and again. The Center for Disease Control, the World Health Organization have all come out to debunk that study, but nonetheless, it is still being preached that there's a relationship between vaccinations and autism, vaccinations and paralysis, vaccinations and any number of kind of things. And parents, some parents are reluctant to take that risk. And so that has been an outbreak. By the way, thimerosal, the preservative that was blamed in the original study, has been withdrawn from vaccines for over a decade. So. But all of those diseases, pertussis, mumps, measles, whooping cough, diphtheria, they're preventable. And it's important to recognize that. How can it impact your business? Well, number one is it can create a loss of productivity, either through loss of your workforce, low morale on the part of your workforce, supply chain disruption. Any of those things can create a loss in productivity, and that ripples down through there. You may, in fact, have a temporary loss of workforce, and even though your employees may not be ill, the Family Medical Leave Act, FMLA, or fear of contagion can also result in people staying away from work because they either have to take care of family or because they're concerned about contracting the disease themselves. Or you can, in fact, in a worst case, have a permanent loss of workforce, and that can be death or disability. And as we were talking before the webinar started, in some areas, loss of a person is a serious, serious issue because those people are not replaceable. Now, it's serious whether they're replaceable or not, but from your business perspective, loss of a person can be devastating beyond just the loss of the person. It can be to the business. You can lose revenue because you're lost productivity. Customers aren't ready to wait around for you. You can suffer from a reduced operational tempo or even suspended operations. All of those things can contribute to a financial strain on the company, whether you're covering temporary staffing or you're paying for overtime, you're looking for an alternative supply source, anything that you need to do, including such things as paying for an unanticipated spike in sick leave, where you have a significant number, 10, 15, 20% of your workforce calls in sick, and you have to pay sick leave for that. So all those things can contribute to a financial strain on the company.
And Guy, I just wanted to add that when you were talking about loss of one person, and the reason we say the loss of one person can be devastating is because if it's the right person, right meaning not right that, I probably didn't say that correctly, but if it's a critical person, if it's a person who has such in-depth knowledge of your company or your processes or that type of thing, and that knowledge has not been captured elsewhere, if you lose that one person, it can seriously disable your business.
Yep. So what are the goals in preparing for a communicable illness outbreak? Obviously, want to maintain operations, want to prevent or slow the spread of disease, and want to make sure we're taking care of our people. We want to have fewer people get ill and nobody die. That's the goals. We want to make sure we do that. And how do we go about doing it? Well, antiviral treatment or vaccinations when they're available. Quarantine for anyone who's exposed. And quarantine can be something like, if you're sick, stay home. Social distancing, not shaking hands, not, you know, back slapping and that kind of stuff when there's an illness around. So we just need to keep, you know, our personal distance, our personal space protected. That's social distancing. Making sure that we have contingency plans and that we're communicating what those plans are. We'll come back and talk about communication a little more. But the graph that you see there on this slide, the light blue shows what can happen if there are no measures taken to prevent the spread of disease. And so you can have a significant number of people get infected, as opposed to the darker area down below, where if you implement effective measures to control and constrain and limit the spread of the disease, you can really keep that down. So that there's a big difference between just letting nature take its course and actively planning to protect your workforce and protect your business. Preparedness can make a significant impact on your business and can mitigate the effects of communicable illness. So what should you do? You should predict, you should plan, and you should perform. You should understand what your vulnerabilities are, develop the policies and procedures, and implement those solutions. And when you've done that and you have tested it and trained on it and perhaps had an event, you can learn from that and feed it back into the prediction cycle and update your plans. And we'll talk about each one of these as we go through the following slides. So when we talk about predict, we want to get started. We want to make sure that there is ownership by the corporate leaders, whether it's the board or the owner or the partners or whoever it is. We want to make sure we have owners at that level. And we'll talk about each of these. We want to have a broad-based plan. What's the risk? What's the potential impact? What are our existing plans and policies? And what are the gaps between what we have and what we need to have? So that's predict phase.
And Guy, I'm going to interrupt again on the predict, plan, perform. That is a process that Firestorm uses for all of the planning, all the emergency planning and preparedness planning that we do. For this, on this particular webinar, we're going to be putting this in the perspective of the communicable illness planning.
Okay, so getting started. Like I said, we need to get ownership at the level of corporate most senior leadership. The leadership, the owners, the CEO, the board of directors, whatever, has a governance responsibility. That responsibility includes making sure the company is prepared for things like communicable illness. Recognizing that responsibility, it is just as important to get their authorization to proceed with planning. That develops the ownership at that level and ensures that there will be that kind of support from the company to put the plan in place. It's also important to put in place a broad-based planning team. Now, if you're a big company, you have someone from human resources or finance or operations. Bring those various functional areas together because they all have a part in planning for communicable illness. If you're a small company that has 5 or 6 people, then maybe human resources, finance, facilities, and communication is all the same person. But you need to bring that perspective to the planning because you need to look at it from all those different perspectives so that you have a plan that is comprehensive for you. And comprehensive doesn't mean you need 500 pages. Comprehensive means you've thought about how it's going to affect these various areas and you have the necessary plans and procedures in place to respond, and you'll see as we go through what some of those might look like. So assess, what are your real risks? So on one of the earlier slides, I had listed some of the communicable illnesses, and I listed dengue fever specifically so that I could talk about it on this slide. Dengue fever is not something that you're going to worry about in Wyoming. It's a tropical disease. It's mosquito borne, but while it is beginning to show up in the continental United States, it's not moving as far north as Colorado or Wyoming. So you need to look at that. You don't have to worry about things like that. But which illnesses are viable threats? Do you really need to worry about Ebola? Do you really need to worry about the flu? Do you really need to worry about whatever? But look at those and look at what the vulnerabilities are based on your geography and also on where you're located. So what's your frequency of international travel? How close are you to a major international airport? Jennifer and I have a client that is located very close to a major international airport, and one of the things that we recommended they seriously consider was to look at that as a threat for communicable illness. And they, you know, they took that recommendation on board. But that is a very important area there. If you're near a major international airport or something like that, then that becomes a major input to your communicable illness plan. You need to look at what's the impact. If I do have a communicable illness, what are my potential losses? Am I really at risk of losing productivity, or do I have ways to compensate for that? Is my cash flow such that a loss of revenue is going to be a serious impact over a period of 2, 3, 4, 5 weeks, or have I the ability to tolerate that? What kind of financial strain am I going to have? And look at those things, because the potential impact and the likelihood of a communicable illness are the things that are going to say what kind of priorities do you have to address the communicable illnesses in a rational manner. So we don't want to use up company resources to address risks that have low impact or low probability. We want to address the hot topics, so the higher risks, the greater impacts. Review the existing plans and policies. So we would hope that there's a plan for communicable illness. We would hope there's a communications plan, recovery plans, possibly even insight into what your critical vendors' plans are. Now, they're your vendors, they're not you, and so that's something that you have to work with the vendors, but those are plans that should be considered, and we should look for gaps in those. Policies, now these policies apply not just to communicable illness, but your employee wellness programs, your compensation programs, any programs that are policies that you have for working remotely via telecommuting, your staffing and cross-training, visitor management policies. Your facility cleanliness policies, any travel or hygiene policies that you have, and finally, what are your policies for emergency closing and reopening of your facilities? All of those need to be considered as you start to look at communicable illness, and look and say what are the things that we should be doing, and where do we have gaps, if any. Legal factors to consider: Americans with disabilities. Or state policies that look at that, obviously OSHA, the Family Medical Leave Act, health insurance portability. If you have international clients, do you have foreign legal requirements? Are there collective bargaining agreements that you have to be aware of? And then there's the Worker Adjustment and Retraining Notification Act, which involves layoffs, should something like that be. They're just to be considered. They're not necessarily major drivers. They're things that need to be considered as we start to look at what kind of plans we have to put in place.
And Guy, I'm going to interrupt. I just wanted to make sure that anyone on the phone realized that if they do have questions, they can ask those questions in the webinar panel to their right. And if they have any questions, we'll try to answer those today. And if we don't get to their questions, we will definitely get in touch with them and answer them.
Yes, absolutely. So additional planning, we talked about vendor preparedness. How prepared are your vendors to deal with a major influenza outbreak or something like that? Might there be workers' compensation considerations in there, or disability? Depending upon the disease, possibly. Health insurance aspects of it. If an employee needs to draw on retirement or pension funds, is that something that needs to be considered? We touched on the remote learning or telework there. Those are things that need to be considered, as well as any exigencies from layoffs, whether that's unemployment or separation pay, that have to be considered. So these are just additional planning considerations. Once again, They don't necessarily have to be a driver, but they are things that need to be considered. With all of that information available, what are the findings? Take a look at those findings, analyze them, understand which ones need to be addressed. Compare that to industry standards and best practices, and identify and list the gaps that exist. And those are the gaps that will be addressed in the planning phase, where we determine what our policies need to be. Understanding the various pandemic phases, looking at triggers for action. What are those things that are going to make us or tell us that we need to make a decision and take some action? Define our processes and procedures. Establish our monitoring plan and our communications plan with our stakeholders, with our employees. So what are the policies? We touched on these really briefly, but sick leave and personnel policies, we need to look at those. Are we going to be making temporary hires? Are we going to be working overtime? Need to look at all of these things and have written policies in place to decide what are going to be the governing direction for these things. And those policies will help us be prepared. The wrong time to make these determinations is when you're under the time pressure of having to do something right now. It is so much more effective and easier to make these decisions sitting around a conference table than in the heat of a communicable illness outbreak.
Guy, so, can you go back one, please?
Yeah.
So I go back one. So we just wanted to mention, you know, and we talk about the sick leave, personal leave, and why you would look at that policy. If you were to have a communicable illness outbreak and a significant percentage of your workforce was out, you kind of need to have decided ahead of time, are these folks going to get paid? Are they going to have to take vacation time? Are they going to have to take a sick leave? If everybody uses all their sick leave at one time, is that going to be a financial burden? Have you planned for, you know, having all those people sick and still being able to afford to bring in temps to do their work, or to have people do overtime to do their work? You know, so what your policies are going to be is really important ahead of time. Also tell a little story. My son's company, it's a big consultancy, I won't mention any names, in D.C., well, actually across the country. But in D.C. they had a really big snowstorm. And they closed the offices, but they told their people that they would be required to take sick leave or vacation pay. So, you know, is that something that you want to do to your employees when something like this happens? Or do you want to have something else in place, some other contingencies in place to make sure that folks get paid? The other thing is, what's your policy to pay people if half your workforce is out sick and they still need to get paid, but you don't want them in your coming into work and making other people sick? So those are all things that, as you look at your policies, you'll want to think through and know what your policy will be if this happens to you. And I apologize for the phone ringing.
Okay, so phases, pandemic phases. The graphic that you see there right now is from the World Health Organization, and those are the phases that the WHO has created to identify the evolution of a pandemic or a communicable illness outbreak throughout the world. So they have their inter-pandemic period, their alert phase, their pandemic phase, and then a transition where they de-escalate response to the pandemic. We at Firestorm have looked at that, and we've said that, you know, that's a good framework. We like that, but we think that businesses and organizations really need to have a little bit more structure in there, because you don't want a step function that says, I go from a virus in Singapore to you know, maximum panic in Wyoming. So we created some additional phases in there. Our pre-action phase lines up with the pandemic, the inter-pandemic and alert phase in the World Health Organization. And that's when there's a disease in animals, but there's no or very limited animal-to-human transmission, such as has been the case with many of the avian flu strains in the last several years. Beyond that, there's an imminent stage where there are human cases, but it's not an efficient transferal. There's not a major outbreak. There are a few cases. You just want to stay aware of that. There's the onset stage where there is potential. There's sustained human-to-human transmission in the U.S., but the risk in your geographic area is still low in your environment, and so you just want to stay aware of that because there's potential for future operational risks. In the onset stage at the elevated level, there's person-to-person contact or in the proximity to your company, and you have moderate risk of it. You really want to start taking action according to your trigger matrix, and we'll show that in a second. The onset stage means it's here, and you need to have your plan full up and running. The post-pandemic recovery stage is, we talk about it in terms of business resumption, getting back to completely normal operations, and it's important to have thought through that also, because you want to make sure that you know when you can reopen with low risk to your employees. You don't want to wait too long. You don't want to start too soon. So all of those are important. We feel that this additional granularity is important for looking at it. So we looked at and broke out the stages a little bit more, and then we identified some areas to be considered and concerned with and to develop response and policies and procedures. So having said that, triggers for these procedures. So for each stage that we just went through, what are the triggers? What are the events that you're going to look for in the world? And where are you going to look for them? And who's going to be the person or team responsible for knowing when to take that critical action? And it's really important to know when to do that and to stay on top of it. We'll touch on those.
Well, and Guy, and it goes back to your comment about, you know, an outbreak in another country should not mean that it's a crisis yet for Wyoming. And
right.
Those stages helps you decide, you know, at what point in the development of a communicable illness do you need to take action, and what action do you need to take at each stage?
So, and building on that, you know, the advantage of having those triggers is that it puts you in a position to take the right action at the right time. Really important. And that those triggers are indicators from the world that decisions have to be made and something's got to be done. So whether it is my favorite person, Fred, or you have a company communicable illness team, those are the people who are empowered to make those decisions. Remember, we talked about ownership of the communicable illness plan at the top level of the company. By doing that, authorizing the planning, they have empowered Fred or the communicable illness team to make those decisions. Now, obviously you're going to want to alert them, but you don't get bound up in the bureaucracy. And those triggers could trigger actions, pardon me, such as alerting the company's employees or canceling events or making preparations for telecommuting or whatever is possible for your company. Now, when you take a look at those, you define a set of processes and procedures and checklists for each stage. What's got to be, what are the activities that you're going to be doing? What specific actions need to be taken to maintain your activity level? Who's going to take the actions? What department is going to do it? How's it going to be broken out so that you are prepared to do it? The checklists are extremely valuable because you don't have to think about it on the fly and make it up as you go along. You have the checklist there to help you walk through it, and it's been developed and tested and trained on. So you have something that you know works for you and gives you a way to move forward quickly and efficiently to protect your people, to protect your business. And one of the things you should think about is protective equipment and supplies, whether that's Purell hand sanitizer or it's latex gloves or it's face masks or whatever it needs to be. Determine the need ahead of time and develop an inventory plan. Not necessarily an inventory, but an inventory plan. If I need to go get extra Purell hand sanitizer, when do I need to go do that, and how much do I need to get, where am I going to buy it, all of those kinds of things, so that you have that done ahead of time and, once again, don't have to invent it on the fly. We also think it's really important that you, in order to be able to activate those trigger points, is to monitor what's going on. And there are two primary sources, government and non-government. So the government websites, local, county, state health agencies that routinely publish information on their websites, as well as the Center for Disease Control, the World Health Organization, also publish that kind of information, and it's available on the web. I strongly urge people that are going to monitor this to go and familiarize themselves with those websites, because they're large websites and the information you specifically need may not be obvious right away. So you should familiarize yourself with those sites so that you can get the information you need easily and quickly. There's also non-government sources that can be leveraged. Local and national media, so the network and cable news outlets, your local television, radio stations, the newspapers. You can look on the internet. You can look at social media. All of those resources are available to you. And as everyone knows, everything that you see on the internet is absolutely true, right? Not. Everything you hear on the internet, everything you hear, period, isn't true. So it's important while you're monitoring to confirm the information from other sources, if at all possible, before acting. It's really important to make sure that what you're hearing is true, because there is a lot of noise in the environment out there. So tracking incidents internally, you can look at, are we experiencing elevated absenteeism because people are sick, they have the flu? Are there in the local area an increasing number of our people going to emergency rooms? Do we have a quarantine imposed? And are we being subject to public perception? Do people think that we have a problem? Those are things that we can track, and we can start to fold that into our planning and our actions. Externally, are there other closures? Are there other business closures? Are there school closures? Are there quarantines in the area? Are hospitals reporting a surge in patients? All of those things are things that we can look at to help us inform ourselves about what we need to do for our company. Communications. Communications is really, really important, and it helps to manage the crisis, to manage what's going on, to keep everybody informed. It builds trust with the employees. It maintains that trust. It helps people understand what's going on and feel comfortable with it, understand that you have their wealth. What happened to me? It helps people understand that you have their interest as well as the company's at heart. Helps and guides and encourages people with the appropriate behaviors and actions and decisions as they go through there. And it encourages people to get together and work together to deal with this outbreak. Clear communications is so important, and it's not something that happens just by happenstance. You need to plan for it. So each stage of an outbreak should include in your communications plan, what are you going to say? Who are you going to say it to? And what's the vehicle, the media that you're going to use? So core messages, okay? The company has your short-term and long-term interest at heart. We're doing these things. Here's what we're going to do. Message maps, which are not scripts, but are just messages that say, if we have to close, we're going to say this kind of a message, and we'll update the information on this kind of a schedule. Pre-crisis information, awareness and education. Make sure that people know ahead of time what the company is going to do in the event of a communicable illness outbreak, so that they are aware of what's going to happen and how to respond to that. Internal and external stakeholders is who you're going to talk to. It's not just the employees. You may want to make sure that their families are aware, that your ownership, your board of directors is aware, that your external customers, suppliers, any government agencies that need to be informed are in fact on the list. You know who to talk to, how to get hold of them, and what it is that you're going to say. And what's the media? So you can reach your employees by your website or by email messages or by social media or by texts or by telephones, or whatever the media is that's appropriate for you to reach any one of those internal or external stakeholders. And when are you going to contact them? At what points in your trigger matrix are you going to deliver what messages to your internal and external stakeholders? And those are all things that need to be included in there so that your employees and your external stakeholders are confident that you are on top of the situation and taking care of your company, taking care of them. So in the perform area, we're going to talk about education and training, practicing, keeping the plan up to date, and executing it. make sure that everyone knows how to protect themselves. So to contain the spread, do these things. You know, it's just common sense. Washing your hands, covering your mouth, don't share drinking cups or utensils or food, for heaven's sakes. Good cleanliness and ventilation, all of those things are important. Social distancing, and make sure that your people know that you encourage and endorse their seeking medical advice if they start to develop symptoms. All of those are important. And get your flu shot. So I would hope that everybody's already gotten theirs, and because that is one of the biggest things that we can do. But we need to make sure that that's going on. So let me go back to that. It's important, once the plan's in place, to do some practice on it. Because when you practice and train and test that, you will find out that there are weak spots in there, that you need to have a backup person for this job or for that job, that you need to be more clear about what the message is. Those are important things. And the lessons learned, as I talked about in the one slide back there, plan or predict, plan, perform, is when you learn from that to feed it back into the front end of your planning cycle and get it there. So make sure you do that. Make sure you do your hand washing. It's a healthy habit. And are there any questions? Do we have any questions right now? Doesn't sound like it. Okay, so our next webinar.
Is Bill on mute? Bill, were there any questions?
Yeah, yes, there are. I've got to get off of mute
let's
here.
Let's give people a moment to think.
Couple of questions. Disaster preparedness is an institutionalized function within the military, but it's not in civilian organizations. What proper level for civilian organizations? How do you assign the right level based on an organization's attributes?
Okay.
Yes, they're saying, how do you organize this whole thing?
Okay, well, number one, this is really important, and it is disaster preparedness is not something that is going to be instituted and effective at a low level. Going back to our slide that said you need to have develop ownership on the part of the board of directors or the CEO or the owner or the partners, that's an important part of it. If they don't have ownership in it, it's very difficult to do it. Now, they're not the ones that need to do the planning, but they do need to have ownership in the plan, and it's very important to have that ownership at that level. Now, it is possible to take the message to those owners and say, this is important and here's why, and it involves presenting the data, presenting the facts that says these are real risks. Now, the risk may be small, it may be, you know, 2% chance of something happening, but if it happens, it could be catastrophic. And while we didn't touch on it, companies that close their doors because of some kind of a disruption, a crisis or an emergency, companies that close their doors, according to FEMA, 40% of them never reopen their doors. And of those that do, a quarter of them, another 15%, a quarter of them fail within 2 years. And of the 40% that, or the 45% that survive that first 2 years after the disaster, they lose significant revenue and corporate company value. So it's a big deal. If an event, a disaster, forces you to close your doors, it is absolutely devastating, and it's devastating for years. So it's important to do that, and the way to approach that is to develop the facts, take it to the owners, take it to the leaders and say, this is important. We think this is important for the welfare and the long-term resilience of the company. We like to say, I'm going to get to you, Jennifer, just a second. Purpose of business is to stay in business, and that means surviving these kinds of things. Jennifer?
I just wanted to add on that. I mean, not only is it important to get ownership at the top, but it is also important to have a person in the company that's going to lead the charge. Once you get ownership, that's great, and you get their support, that's great. Then you have to have a person that say, okay, this belongs to me, and I'm going to push it forward. And there's, depending on the size of your company, it depends on the size of your company, who else you would bring in to help you, what kind of help you need outside, inside, that type of thing. But just, you know, have one person in charge of it and let them get going on it.
You know, and Jennifer and I have talked to some big companies who have a specific person and team in place, and they're pretty good. I mean, they're really pretty good. When you're a smaller company, it's likely to be a collateral duty, but that doesn't mean it's any less important because it is. So, Jennifer, anything else?
Not on that one. Bill, I think we have other questions.
Well, yeah, another question came in, and right across the sweet spot of the place. Do you have any metrics that can support the advantage of having a plan?
Well, the metrics that pop to mind right away are that, you know, 40% of companies that close their doors in the event of an emergency or crisis never reopen. That's the dominant one, and that's a FEMA number. And there have been a number of studies that come up with roughly those same kinds of numbers that talk about how important it is to have that kind of preparedness. And you know, it is a difficult area because it does take resources. It takes someone's time. It takes some kind of money to put these plans in place and to practice them. And so we recognize that. But the real question is not what is the return on your investment there. What happens if you don't invest and you experience a problem? It can easily be devastating. Whereas had you had a plan in place, you would have been able to quickly, effectively, and efficiently deal with the crisis, deal with the emergency, and perhaps emerge stronger than when you went into it. Anything okay. else, Bill?
Well, one little tidbit question. What year did you graduate from the Naval Academy, Guy?
1969. It's 45 years.
My goodness. Graduated when you were a kid.
And Bill, I see one more thing here that somebody made a statement about, well, Ebola is not a current crisis in the U.S. They made the comment that it can affect international trade and economic development. In ways that we should prepare for, and we can't agree with that more, which is, you know, part of we talk about your supply chain and your supply chain's readiness and the plans that they have in place, because if you have an international supply chain, even if it's a couple of levels down, it can affect your business. So it Absolutely. Is really important.
Absolutely. So anything else?
Yeah. I know. Amanda, any closing comments?
Yeah, let's talk about the next webinar, which is next month we have a webinar that's 5 common failures of business that can lead to disaster. And what we're talking about is failures of businesses in a crisis that causes the crisis to escalate and become a disaster, things that can be mitigated and things that companies can do to avoid those failures. And then next, Guy, I think you also have.
We do.
We have a workshop that's coming up in next month that's called Readiness Business Survival. This is a full-day workshop, and we'll be talking about not just communicable illness, but all of the different risks that might be affecting your company, how you take an all-hazards approach to those risks, and then how to go about mitigating those risks through planning, training, exercising.
Yep. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm sure people will be interested to know that coming to this workshop will also help give them a preparedness assessment that they can walk away with that will show them, okay, you guys are doing pretty well in this area, but here's a gap that you haven't really covered, and give some direction to where to go from there.
Yeah,
is that right?
Yes, great point. Yes, we will do an assessment for every company that attends the workshop. And also, we put those little stars in there for you, Amanda, that it qualifies for workforce training yes. grants if you sign up by the 17th.
Yes. So really, this week, get it done this week if you want to get a workforce training grant to cover 60% of your cost of going to this workshop. To be sure that you've got all your paperwork in and you're ready and you don't have to worry about missing the deadline. Another thing I'd like to mention is I know some of the people listening are from areas in other parts of the state besides the Cheyenne area, and Guy and Jennifer have said that they might be willing to travel around. So if there is a company or a group that wants some of this knowledge to be brought to them in a different area, just let us know. We would be happy to work out a date and a place that works for you.
Yep. So if you need help with any of this, don't hesitate. Now, I get to pass the ball here. Don't hesitate to call Amanda. And there's her contact information. If you can't get hold of Amanda, please don't hesitate to call me or to call Jennifer. There's our contact information. We'll be happy to talk to you and see what we can do to help.
Especially if you have any specific questions about the material that we presented today or anything about business continuity, disaster preparedness, crisis management, crisis communications, any of those type of things, we're happy to have you come to us as well.
True. Absolutely true.
Great.
Thank you for your time today, Amanda.
Thank you, Guy and Jennifer, both for sharing your expertise, and thank you everyone for joining the webinar today.
Have a good day and stay warm. Get your flu shot.